In this lecture, I will first say we will talk some more about NFA to DFA conversion, about the conversion procedure that we described last time. What was the name of that procedure that we described? The subset construction, yes. And why is it called the subset construction? Yes, sir.
Each new state is a subset of the previous states of the NFA.
Okay, this is much clearer. Yeah. So each state in the DFA that we construct, corresponds to a subset of the states in the original NFA. So each state in the DFA In the DFA that we construct corresponds to a subset of the states in the original NFA. Okay, so that's why it's called the subset construction. Now, how many subsets are there? If you have an NFA with N states, then the equivalent DFA then the equivalent DFA will have how many states? 2n, in fact, up to. Why up to 2n states, not 2n states exactly? What's that?
It could use less than...
Because some states, and the way we described the construction last time, we first put all 2n states. Of course, all 2n was only 4 states for the example that we did last time, because the n was 2, and 2n was 4. So, you know, using the word all is too big for what we did last time. But in general, 2n is really a large number, right? So for, this is n. This is n and this is 2n. So if n is 10, then 2n is 2 power 10, which is 1k. So that's approximately equal to 10 power 3. It's exactly 1024. Right? And if n is 100, then 2 power n is 2 power 20, which is...
2 power 100?
If it's 20, then it's 2 power 20, which is...
10 to 6.
This is 1 mega, so this is approximately 10 power 6. This is a million. So this is 1k, this is 1 mega. 30, it's 2 power 30, which is 10 power 9, or... This is 1 giga. Okay? Now, why am I doing this? To show you how big the number of states in the equivalent DFA can be. So clearly, the number of states in the equivalent DFA that we are constructing can be a large number. So large that it's, in fact, the procedure that we described last time is impractical. Impractical because it first constructs a DFA that has all 2 power n states, okay, and then it eliminates the redundant or unreachable states, right? So constructs all 2 power n and then it eliminates the unreachable ones. In fact, in the compiler's course, we describe a more efficient procedure for doing a conversion in which we don't construct all 2 power n. We only worry about the states that are reachable. So that other procedure, we're not going to study it here. I'm just going to briefly describe it. And then I will refer you to the recorded lecture on that. There is a recorded lecture that describes the other procedure that avoids going through 2 power n states, which is like, as you can see, if the NFA has 30 states, using the procedure that we described last time, there will be a billion states in the DFA. Yes?
Is it represented by billion G or B? Where you have 10 to the 9.
Yeah, 10 power 9.
1 G is about 1
giga. 1 giga. This is 1 giga. This is 1 billion. Okay, so if you have 30 states in the NFA, you will have a billion states in the equivalent DFA, which is a large number. In fact, if you have 100, you'll have 2 power 100, and this is a huge number. So this is like, this is 20, 30, so this is like 10 power 6, 10 power 9, 10 power 6, 10 power 9. So this is 10 power 30. And in the algorithms course, we show that if there is an algorithm that performs 10 power 30 operations, that's going to take millions of billions of years on one of the, if it runs on a typical desktop or workstation. By the way, the speed of the machine doesn't matter. If I tell you that 10 power 30 is going to take a million billion years to execute, then if you run it on a computer that's a million times faster, it's going to take only a billion years. Okay? So it's very important, in computer science to be aware of, what the exponential function does. To be aware of the fact that algorithms with exponential running times are impractical unless the size of the input is very small. For a large enough input size, exponential algorithms are impractical. Because they can take inferior, of course, billions of years, or they're not going to terminate within our lifetimes or the lifetimes of our grandchildren. Okay? So the algorithm that I described last time was exponential. There is a way of avoiding this by only considering the states that are reachable. So that other algorithm that we study in the compiler's course, it first starts with, so here's the NFA. So the NFA, and this is the DFA. So it first looks at the start state of the NFA. So given the algorithm that we did last time, if the NFA has a start state of n0, what will be the start state for the corresponding DFA?
Any of the subsets that include n0?
No, that was the case for the accept state. That was for the accept state. That was the rule for the accept state, not for the start state. How does the start state for the DFA relate to the start state of the NFA? Yes.
The epsilon closure.
Yes.
Closure.
It's the epsilon closure of n0. So this state here, d0 for the NFA, is the epsilon closure. It corresponds to the epsilon closure of n0. And the epsilon closure here, for example, if this is q0, the epsilon closure of q0 are the states that are reachable from Q0 via epsilon transitions. So the epsilon closure of Q0 is the set Q0 itself, Q1, Q2, and Q5. Okay? So here, this state is different, and you start from this. This is going to be the seed of your program. You start with this. Then you only need to worry about the states that are reachable by this D0 that you have constructed. So from Q0, D0, there will be only a small subset of the sets that are reachable by D0. And that's all that you need to worry about. Then, you know, suppose that you construct D1, D2, and D3, which corresponds to some subsets in the original NFA. Then, now you have these sets, and then you, all that you need to worry about are the set of, is the set of states that are reachable by these, D1, D2, D3. So if you keep, you start with D0, and you only worry about the states that are reachable from D0, then you worry about the states that are reachable from the new states that you create. You will only look at reachable states, and you will never get to explicitly touch an unreachable state. And in the compiler's course, I show an example where n is 10, I think. So there are 10 states in the NFA. So in the worst case, there is 2 power 10, which is 1024 states in the DFA up to. So this is the worst case. But the algorithm that only visits reachable states, I think will visit a limited number of states, like 10 or even 10, 12, something in that range, instead of visiting 1024. You know, I couldn't have done an example with 1024 states on the whiteboard. Right. You can never fit 1,024 on the whiteboard. So, just so that you know, you are aware of this point about the algorithm that we described last time. It's exponential, and whenever you hear exponential in computer science, exponential algorithms are not gonna complete within reasonable time unless the input size is really small. Or unless the worst case is rate. You know, there are algorithms, exponential algorithms with a worst case exponential running time, but the worst case is unlikely. In fact, you know, this algorithm that only visits reachable states has a worst case of exponential. It has an exponential worst case, which is 2 power n, but it will never enumerate that many DFA states. Okay, now what's important? Someone asked last time. Well, there were two questions that were asked last time that I would like to answer today. So, a very important question that was asked towards the end of last lecture was, can we use this procedure to convert any NFA into a DFA? And the answer is yes. We can use the procedure. Why? Because it's general. If we're not giving a formal proof that this algorithm is general, but it should be clear that the algorithm is general. We're not making any assumptions about the NFA. We can handle any NFA. And to convince yourself that this algorithm is general, well, you can either look at the formal proof in the book, or you can try to come up with an NFA that cannot be converted using this algorithm. So try to construct an NFA that cannot be converted into a DFA using this algorithm. And, you know, I can assure you that you will not find any. It's a very general algorithm. It just says, you know, there is a general way of handling any set of states in the NFA, any set of transitions. There is a general way of figuring the start state for the DFA. The general rule is the start state of the DFA is the epsilon closure of the start state in the NFA. There is a general rule for figuring the accept states in the DFA. And the accept states in the DFA are the states that have, that correspond to a substate or that have a intercept for each DFA state. Each DFA state is a set of states in the NFA, and if one of these states, like, you know, N1, N2 through N sub M, If one of them is an accept state, then D1 is an accept state. If none of them is an accept state, then D1 is not an accept state. So this algorithm is general, which means that any NFA can be converted into a DFA. Now, this, we seem to have a, now, an important piece of information that we need to know is that the set of languages that can be recognized by DFAs is called regular languages. So a regular language of course, here we're talking about programming languages or formal languages?
Formal
languages. Yeah, this course is about formal languages. A regular language is a language that can be recognized by a DFA. Now, can we say, can we also define a regular language as a language that can be recognized by an NFA? Yeah, because the procedure that we showed last time, it just proves that any NFA can be converted into a DFA. So if you can recognize a language using an NFA, you will be able to recognize it using a DFA, because when I talked about the delta transition for Q0 and A, I gave Q0 and A, we can have Q1, Q2, or Q5. But someone suggested that why don't we just take the epsilon first and take the epsilon to Q2, and then Q3 will belong to the delta of Q0 and A. In fact, you can define it this way and you can define it this way, and both will lead to the same result as far as the subset construction is concerned. Now, is this clear? Can anyone tell me why, whether we do it this way or this way, in the subset construction, it won't matter? Yes?
Because in the subset construction, we wouldn't ever be just in Q0, we'd be in the entire epsilon closure of Q0. So, sure, you could look at the first delta definition, right? And we wouldn't be able to go to Q3, but the thing is that we would also be in Q2 at that time, and so we could take the A transition to Q3.
Exactly. That's a very good answer. Yes. Was that you who asked the question last time? Yeah. So you have a good answer. You are answering yourself. So it doesn't matter. Here, it may seem like we are missing something. We're missing Q3, but we're not actually missing it. Because Q0 will never be in a state by itself. It will always, the states that are in the epsilon closure of Q0 will be in the same state with Q0. And the state that will have Q0 by itself will necessarily get eliminated. The state that has Q0 by itself will always get eliminated. Why? Because you will never stay in it, okay? You will never stay in it, and it will always be, it will always go to some other state. And it will never be reachable, in fact. Because what will be reachable is the bigger state that has the epsilon that will take care of the, that will take into account the epsilon closure. Okay? So are we now clear on NFAs, the relation between NFAs, DFAs, and regular languages?